Hello and welcome to Community Chats. I'm your host, Aley Hammer, and today we're joined with Jasminder Hayer, an aerospace and satellite solutions architect here at AWS. Jas, welcome to the show. Here at AWS, we've set up industry verticals. So can you share with our audience, why is it that we have teams specializing in specific industries here at AWS?
Hey, Aley, thank you for having me. Space data and technology are tackling complex issues on Earth and, you know, transforming lives from deep space exploration, detecting bushfires or wildfires, and saving lives to smarter farming. So organizations are using space data in very innovative ways and redefining how we search and make decisions. Satellites are orbiting around the Earth and collecting enormous amounts of data every day. According to one of our customers, Descartes Labs, satellite collection will grow from 3 million square kilometers a day to 3 billion over the next 5 years. We're reaching a point where it's impossible to store and analyze this data manually. And making sense of the data will require cloud computing. Yeah. AWS created Aerospace and Satellite Solutions business segment based on our listening to our customers, who asked that we bring these best practices, industry experience, and continue to build and invent on their behalf. As you know, 90% of what we build comes from our customer requests, and 10% is us listening on our customers' behalf. So within at AWS, our ANS business segment focuses on innovation and creative solutions, particularly within the aerospace-focused customers and partners. That could be space exploration, satellite services, where we can have a significant impact on our customers' missions.
Well, it definitely makes sense that our customers wanted best practices and industry experience for their specific use cases. And how amazing that your team are providing resources that, you know, uniquely meet the needs of aerospace customers. It's such a niche. You definitely, Jas, I wanted to say, have one of the coolest verticals here at AWS. You're very lucky to be in the space vertical. But I want to know, what is it that you're seeing in the aerospace industry? Any trends that you can fill us in on?
Absolutely. Space is increasingly becoming an area of focus for both governments in Asia Pacific and beyond. Morgan Stanley estimates that the global space industry will grow to more than $1 trillion by 2040, which includes the growing public sector interest in this segment. Space will also positively impact adjacent industries like IT hardware, telecommunications, agriculture, mining, climate monitoring and change, and many other industries. Space is one of the six key priority areas for the Australian government, who has a $1.5 billion modern manufacturing strategy in place. So by enabling public sector organizations to advance space and organizational capabilities, AWS is helping the Asia Pacific region to help build space infrastructure and industry resilience in that way. The Singapore government has earmarked space as one of the new industry clusters that it's focused on as well. South Korea recently announced that it'll invest $1.3 billion over the next 10 years to expedite the development of the key space technologies they require. And also the Japan space industry is estimated at $10 billion annually, with the government trying to double the size by the early 2030s.
Incredible. I mean, I had no idea that the space industry was set to grow by more than $1 trillion by 2040. I did read that somewhere as well. It's absolutely insane. And with all that growth, what are some of the more exciting things that our customers are doing? Like, Jas, what I wanted to ask you is, you know, if you can share any of the cutting edge use cases that you're observing that our customers are building, that would be so great.
This is the best part of me being able to tell my customer stories, I have to say. So today, customers around the world, and I have to say, because space is such a global business, are using AWS cloud services and solutions. And that could be things like data lakes or storage, edge computing, virtual mission operations, or connectivity solutions like AWS Ground Station to process images and machine learning and create end-to-end solutions. One such customer from Australia, High Earth Orbit Robotics, or HEO Robotics, they assess the risk of orbital debris and evaluate the state of a satellite. So I know it sounds technical, but once you put a satellite in orbit, you need to know how it is, how it's behaving, whether it's been impacted or hit by something. So they use space-based assets, existing satellites, and they repurpose them to focus on other satellites, and instead of launching their own. And so they're mitigating rather than contributing to space debris. Just for an idea, the space surveillance network, which is a global network, it tracks more than 27,000 pieces of space junk, which pose a risk to active satellites in orbit today. In Australia, again, ECSI monitors, uses satellite imagery to monitor and protect communities from wildfires. They process more than 2.5 million images every day to identify the outbreak of a wildfire within 3 minutes and let authorities know, or first responders know, where a fire may be breaking out. This 3 minutes can have a huge impact and save massive lives. In Singapore, EO Factory, which is an artificial intelligence-based observation analytics platform, is launching its Insight Studio for Earth observation on AWS, again, to help farmers, help industries make key decisions, driving sustainable practices. In India, to help farmers achieve better outcomes, AWS partner Satshore, which has a decision intelligence platform, has been working with governments locally, like the government of Telangana, to provide space-based intelligence for effective agricultural practices and risk monitoring. So Satshore uses AWS again to help build planetary scale applications. Again, the global aspect of space solutions, using cloud as well as open data from AWS Registry of Open Data as well. And lastly, something a bit more edge is how will humans explore, experiment, and sustain themselves long term in space in low Earth orbit? Orbital Reef is one such organization which is building the next generation of space stations, and which is currently in development to help commercialize and provide research capabilities in space to organizations. So AWS and Amazon are helping Orbital Reef in reimagining what networking, logistics, and communication will look like, which will be an integral part of the space station, as you can imagine. So these are just some of the customers we're working with today within this industry.
Absolutely incredible. Thank you so much for sharing, because, you know, sometimes people don't know what types of customers are doing in this space, but it's so cool to hear a large array of different examples there. Jas, we've spoken a little bit about why Amazon, you know, verticalized our industries, but what does this actually mean for our customers? What are they getting out of it when, you know, they know that there's a specialized team working just on space, for instance?
I think cloud computing is going to play such a critical role in the next frontier of space exploration, communication, and innovation. So the most effective way we know to gain faster insights, get answers, and make decisions from space-based data is with cloud technologies like machine learning and artificial intelligence. And with the massive increase in satellite launches, data analytics will play a huge role in being able to synthesize and analyze that data coming down from satellites. Just as importantly, we know that customers need to access and share this data globally and securely as well. So AWS is enabling governments and commercial customers across the globe to share data seamlessly, both across multiple levels of security and certification levels. Also, we know that we're helping partners today store and analyze these huge amounts of data very, very quickly and efficiently. So, because that's what we do every day. Based on, again, listening to our customers to access their satellite data faster at a lower cost, AWS developed the ground station capability, which enables customers to communicate with the satellites, transmit and receive data in multiple regions around the world. At the moment, we have 10 ground station sites, which can be used globally by customers, and the data can be downlinked or downloaded and put in any other part of the world as required by customers, making it very cost effective. Instead of building and managing your own ground station infrastructure, which can be very expensive, you can consume the ground station service and only pay for the time you use it for. An example of that is Adelaide-based company called Miriota, which have built a satellite IoT connectivity provider. It's enabling customers to send IoT-driven insights at a very low cost from anywhere on Earth. As an AWS partner, so Miriota uses AWS for its data storage and processing and cloud-based delivery. AWS is going to continue to expand its global footprint of ground station sites, building antenna systems at and near AWS regions, and where our customers really need that capability. around the world, with more regions coming up as well to be supported, as well as more satellite locations coming soon.
So incredible, Jas. To round off this interview, everyone keeps talking about space domain awareness. So I want to know, what is it and why the heck is it important?
So collisions in space are a growing risk due to the rising chance. You know, we have so many more launches happening every other week. If you were to follow the news, you'll say there's always satellites being launched in the hundreds, if not thousands at a certain time, and deploying, you know, spacecrafts, multiple stages of spacecrafts as well. So this there's a continuation risk of fragmentation. Even a single collision can create thousands of pieces of debris. And the biggest risk is from these 600,000 to 900,000 pieces, of which are uncatalogued, untracked, and they range anywhere between 5 centimeters to 10 centimeters. Oh, sorry, 5 millimeters to 10 centimeters. So they're very small, and they're all estimated to be in the low Earth orbit. Space domain awareness is the ability to know and understand what is flying overhead, effectively, so that you can either avoid it or take measures to go around it, so that you don't damage any of your spacecraft as well. AWS customers Leo Labs tracks thousands of these objects per hour using very unique ground-based sensors and radars globally, and they operate around the clock, and they are able to track debris as small as 2 centimeters. They provide these insights through a software as a service platform, and they deliver something around 526 measurements every day and in excess of 18,000 conjunction messages, which is when two satellites are likely to collide or come close to each other. Other customers like Digantara out of India are building solutions like Space Climate and Object Tracker to track even debris smaller than 1 centimeter in size using satellites, and provide an update up-to-date tracking service and catalog to satellite operators everywhere.
Absolutely mind-boggling. This is such an interesting chat, Jas. As I said before, you're definitely one of the cooler jobs here at Amazon. I'm very jealous you get to work with such cool customers. Thank you so much for coming on the show. No, I'm not jealous. I really love my role, but it sounds very cool. But Jas, thank you so much. If anyone has any questions, please pop them in the comment section below and we'll get back to you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.